For decades, the majority consensus in dinosaur paleontology was that Tyrannosaurus rex was the only large-bodied theropod in its environment. Its hatchlings started out tiny, as all baby dinos did, and for the first 10 to 12 years of their lives were long-legged, slender, wicked-fast hunters. They were just so good at what they did that no other land carnivores in that one-ton size class could succeed in such a competitive environment. But not everybody believed that. In 1988, a Tyrannosaur specimen previously assigned to Gorgosaurus was redescribed as a new taxon, Nanotyrannus lancensis, the pygmy tyrant from Lance. It was presented as a 1,000 to 1,500 kilogram speedy hunter that coexisted with Tyrannosaurus rex, focusing on the smaller animals of Late Cretaceous North America. It had longer arms than T-Rex and more teeth, distinguishing it from its much larger relative. But for decades, this was a fringe hypothesis, almost ridiculed as a conspiracy theory. The differences between the two animals were individual variation and changes that occurred during growth. The Nanotyrannus holotype and another referred, more complete specimen known as Jane were examples of juvenile Tyrannosaurus rex, nothing more. And to suggest otherwise was to make yourself a pariah in the paleontology community. But one incredible fossil changed everything. The Dueling Dinosaurs, held at the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences, is a historic find that was finally described in October 2025. The block preserved a young Triceratops found articulated with a Tyrannosaur, frequently cited as a juvenile Tyrannosaurus. Well, not anymore. With the description of the Dueling Dinosaurs, including an in-depth analysis of the 100% complete Tyrannosaur, we now know beyond a reasonable doubt that this animal was not a T-Rex. It's a Nanotyrannus lancensis, and its existence completely changes our understanding of the ecology of Late Cretaceous North America. First off, we need to discuss how it was decided that the Dueling Dinosaurs Tyrannosaur was not, in fact, a young T-Rex. I will be drawing heavily on the new paper by Lindsay Zano and James Napoli. It's also linked in the description, so I recommend you read it for yourself. The bones in the arms and hands. This was something I first saw for myself during my recent trip to the Black Hills Institute, where I saw Nanotyrannus claw and arm material next to that of adult Tyrannosaurus. The nanobones dwarfed the corresponding elements in the T-Rex, even those of the giant Rex Sioux. I struggled to see how individual variation or ontogeny could account for such dramatic size differences there. As Zano and Napoli point out, bones don't shrink during growth, unless you're suggesting that T-Rex underwent a tadpole-like metamorphosis as a teenager, where it reabsorbed bone and shrunk parts of its skeleton on its path to adulthood. A similar explanation would be required for the number of maxillary teeth, or teeth in the top part of the jaw. Nanotyrannus has 15 to 17 maxillary teeth, while T-Rex has, at absolute maximum, 12. We don't see teeth falling out and not growing back. We see that Nanotyrannus has more tooth sockets, something that doesn't change during ontogeny in vertebrates and is addressed in detail in another paper by Napoli from 2024, also linked in the description. As he points out in the 2025 paper, there are some theropod dinosaurs that lose their teeth in exchange for beaks, but traces of those teeth remain that can be detected with CT scans. Adult Tyrannosaurus doesn't have those traces, indicating that they always had the maximum 12 maxillary teeth, while Nanotyrannus always had 15 to 17. But of course, there's even more evidence than that. Nanotyrannus has a sinus, or air pocket, inside the bone of its quadratojugal, which is at the top part of the back of the jaws. Tyrannosaurus doesn't have that sinus, and sinuses don't disappear during growth, instead getting bigger. Napoli's research on crocodilian ontogeny bears that out. Nanotyrannus has 35 tail or caudal vertebrae, as opposed to T-Rex's 42 to 43. Add to that the fact that the Dueling Dinosaur's Nanotyrannus, Bloody Mary, even has a vestigial third finger on its hand, something else not present in Tyrannosaurus. And then the idea that we've so carefully cultivated of T-Rex juveniles being slim murder string beans until their teenage years suddenly comes crashing down. And histological analysis showed that Bloody Mary was 14 years old, being very conservative, and at least 20 years old using similar standards from other Tyrannosaur histology papers. It was fully grown when it died, only reaching about 700 kilograms as opposed to the 9,000 plus you'd expect for a fully grown Tyrannosaurus. As the paper itself deftly puts it, even in the absence of histological evidence indicating that several Nanotyrannus specimens were in the asymptotic growth stage at death, the proposed character transformations in this taxonomic scenario cannot be attributed plausibly to ontogeny. And Nanotyrannus lancensis isn't the only nanospecies either. Calm down, take a deep breath. The Nanotyrannus holotype is from the Lower Hell Creek Formation and belongs to Nanotyrannus lancensis. Bloody Mary is from the Lower Hell Creek Formation and belongs to Nanotyrannus lancensis. And Jane, the specimen treated as a juvenile rex in growth and biomechanical studies for the past 20 years, is from the Upper Hell Creek Formation and belongs to Nanotyrannus litheus, a totally new species coined by Zano and Napoli. The species name litheus refers to the Lethe River from Greek mythology, which was the river of forgetfulness that symbolizes Jane being reborn as a new species. The two species are still extremely closely related, separated by some osteological characters across the skull, vertes, scapula, and limbs. The paper mentions body size as another separating characteristic of the two, with Bloody Mary at about 700 kilograms while just about completely grown, while Jane was already 800 kilos with several more years of active growth to go. It is worth noting that the phylogenetic analysis from the paper places Petey, another specimen previously thought to be juvenile Rex, as closer to Nanotyrannus lancensis, the holotype in Bloody Mary, than to Nanotyrannus litheus, Jane. Petey is also bigger than Jane, but was close to being fully grown at 900 kilograms. A projected fully grown Jane would have weighed about 1,264 kilos, according to the paper's new histological analysis, so Nanotyrannus may have gotten bigger as a genus over time. We're likely looking at a range of 700 to 1,200 plus kilograms for a typical fully grown Nanotyrannus, with a caveat. The paper calculated their mass estimates based on femur circumference, which, while useful for very rough comparisons, is nowhere near as precise as more advanced volumetric methods. However, Napoli has said that 3D models are in the works, which will give us a better idea of their actual size. The phylogenies that came about as a result of this discovery have some interesting implications. In one result, the tiny tyrannosaur Moros intrepidus, which lived in Utah about 96 million years ago, clated most closely with Jane, or Nanotyrannus litheus. Moros was nearly fully grown at about 78 kilograms, possibly representing an early nanotyrannid a tenth the size of later varieties that originated from Asia and would have crossed over a land bridge about 100 million years ago. Another result indicated that Dryptosaurus and Appalachiosaurus were within the proposed family Nanotyrannidae, and that these long-armed, fast tyrannosaurs were from the eastern United States and crossed over to the Hell Creek Formation once the western interior seaway receded. However it got there, we definitely have a non-T-Rex, extremely fast, powerful medium-game hunter in the Hell Creek Formation. How fast, you may ask? A 2024 study by Boai and Swan examined the Jane specimen, now Nanotyrannus litheus, and suggested a top speed between 19.4 and 32.4 miles an hour, or 31 to 52 kilometers an hour. Given how biomechanical models from bones can't account for soft tissue structures that allow for higher speeds, I'd expect this animal to be even faster than calculated here, but either way, it would be a speed demon. I've seen Nanotyrannus described as the Prince of Hell, referencing the formation it was from, and I'd agree with that sentiment. It's a theropod up to 2 times the size of a polar bear, faster than the fastest Olympic sprinters, and with a bite of 5,600 newtons, strong enough to gouge through bone. So how did this animal fit into the broader ecosystem of Hell Creek? For one thing, while Nanotyrannus has been suggested to be a pack hunter, I have yet to encounter evidence that suggests it hunted in large cooperative groups. It's certainly possible, but that would just be speculation. The paper suggests that the apomorphically hypercursorial hindlimb proportions of Nanotyrannus suggest that this taxon was a pursuit predator, which may have preferred smaller, faster prey items than Tyrannosaurus. It may have specialized in the pachycephalosaurs and kinognathids that were too fleet-footed for bigger predators to catch, chasing them down in the humid woodlands of Hell Creek. Young T-Rexes, on the other hand, appear to have been robust and heavily built from an earlier age, suggesting that they specialized in big prey from the beginning. They potentially could have attacked hadrosaurs and ceratopsians with help from their parents. Speaking of robust T-Rex, this paper provides circumference data for a T-Rex femur that had gone previously unmeasured. TCMI 2003-66-1 appears to have been an adult, still undergoing minimal growth when it died, with a minimum femoral circumference of 535 millimeters, increasing by a millimeter or so each year. We can't really calculate size effectively off a single measurement of a single bone, but it may indicate a size roughly comparable to that of the holotype, and would be the new smallest Tyrannosaurus that you can argue is skeletally mature, taking a spot from Trix. We do have remains of teenage T-Rex, including Bucky and Terry, as I discussed in my most recent video, and Lindsay Zano has implied that further research is appearing on the subject of juvenile Rexes. So no, there's not some mystery absence of juvenile Rexes, that isn't a thing, as Gregory S. Paul pointed out recently. I disagree with him on a number of points, but he's right in that the hand-wringing about a supposed dearth of young T-Rex specimens really just isn't supported by the available data. We've got them, now let's study them. What are your thoughts on Nanotyrannus, both lancensis and litheus? How does this change your understanding of the ecology of Hell Creek, and how do you imagine the two tyrannosaur genera coexisted and competed with one another for 2 million years? I, for one, am extremely interested to find out more about the dueling dinosaurs, given that detailed descriptions will eventually be released. Paleontology as a field is accelerating so quickly that it's difficult to keep up with, and I love it. The more information there is about the amazing ancient life from this planet, the better. Thanks for watching. If you like dinosaurs and think they're awesome, you might enjoy checking out my book Extinction, Obsidian, Dawn, which does indeed feature tyrannosaurs of various species. You can also subscribe to learn more about these animals, since I talk about theropods pretty frequently. What other paleontological marvels would you like to see covered? Let me know. I'm the Vividen, and I'll see you the next time a crazy study drops a month earlier than I thought it was going to.